Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
There was a lot of reading of scripture, wasn't it? Two full chapters. Chapters 2 and chapter 7 of 2 Corinthians. I had not intended for us necessarily to read all of those because I will not refer to every verse that we just read. But I want us to see just how honest the Bible is and how honest Paul is about circumstances and situations in the church there at Corinth. Corinth was not Paul's favorite church, most likely. There was a lot of troubles there. In 1 Corinthians, we read that there were divisions in the church. They had kind of split up. Some were followers of Paul, some were followers of Apollos, some were followers of Cephas, or Peter, as we know him better, and then some are followers of Jesus as well. So there were these divisions in the church. Then we found some people filing lawsuits against one another. In chapter 5, we find immorality, sexual immorality in the church as well. So Paul had dealt with a lot of things in the Corinthian church. When I spoke to you last month, we talked about a subsequent problem that had occurred in the life of the church, and we see in the first four verses of 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And that was that Paul had said, I will try my best to come and visit you. I'm on my way to Macedonia, but on my way I'm going to stop and visit with you. And then he changed his mind. He did not come. And so the people in Corinth were accusing him of bowing out of a commitment he had made. You said yes, you were coming, and now you say no. Is it yes, yes, or no, no? So Paul had to deal with that issue. And we read in those first few verses that Paul did not come because of distress and anguish of heart that he was feeling because of a letter of rebuke that he had written to them. That letter of rebuke, some people say was in a lost letter, or some of it is found in chapters 10 through 13 of 2 Corinthians. But nevertheless, Paul did not go there because they weren't ready to hear him. and they weren't prepared spiritually and emotionally for what he had said. But he made it very clear that he had a great depth of love for the Corinthians. But the reason he didn't come was not because he didn't care, because he did care and felt like that was not the right time to come. So Paul had to make a decision. And then those next few verses in 2 Corinthians dealt with the forgiveness of someone who had sinned in the life of the church. It could have been, as I shared with you last month, the person that's referred to in chapter 5, who had been had a sinful relationship with his stepmother in terms of a sexual relationship. And he had been disciplined. He had been dismissed from the church until he repented. And the forgiveness for the sinner could well have been this person from chapter 5 of 1 Corinthians 1, 2 Corinthians 5, who had now repented. And Paul is saying, look, if you don't forgive him for what he's done, then Satan is going to have a victory here. Because that's what he wants. He wants Christians not to forget. He wants Christians to hold grudges and say, you did something bad, we don't have anything to do with you. But Paul said, we need to be aware of the schemes of Satan because that's what he wants. But that's not what the church is about. And I want us to come to verse 12 now of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Because we've looked at this last month up until here. Because this is really, really an amazing set of circumstances. Paul said in verse 12, now when I went to Troas to preach the gospel of Christ and found that the Lord had opened a door for me, I still had no peace of mind because I did not find my brother Titus there. So I said goodbye to them and went on to Macedonia. Now that is really a strange thing for Paul to say. he's telling us that in the city of Troas, the people were receptive to hear the gospel. They had an open, it was an open door. Whenever Paul had an open door to preach the gospel, what did he do? He preached. He shared. He taught. And Paul had been given of God a tremendous amount of Holy Spirit power to share and preach in such a way that hundreds of people have come to Christ all over the Roman Empire. But here it says that he was unable to preach. He was unable to speak. Why? Because he said his brother in Christ, Titus, had not come. We'll see in a moment in chapter 7 that Paul apparently had sent Titus to try to find out how things were going in Corinth. He wanted to know, have they repented? Are they back together? Because obviously there had been a lot of splintering of the group. There was a lot of anxiety and problems in the life of the church. There was a lack of joy. There was a lack of unity and continuity. And Paul felt like in this situation, he was not the man to handle it. And Paul was so wise, he sent Titus to take care of that, to work on it. He knew it was not going to be easy. It was not going to be simple. But he had such a strong belief that Titus was the right man for the job. One of the things I want us to see, one of the principles here is that God sometimes uses other people to solve difficult issues and circumstances. Now, we think of Paul as being probably the greatest follower of Christ that ever lived. Paul owned his life to Jesus Christ. He was so totally devoted to Jesus. It's hard for us to think Paul and Jesus should be able to solve this problem. But he's saying in this situation, Titus is the key person. He's saying Titus is the person that needs to do this. Because he felt like God was saying to Paul, send Titus. He wasn't just operating God in second place here and Titus in first place. No. But in his great understanding of what God wanted him to do and being led by the Holy Spirit, it was Titus who had this responsibility. And so when you read that again, he said, I had no peace of mind because I did not find my brother Titus there. So Paul has arrived in Corinth. So I said goodbye to them and went on to Macedonia. And then in verse 14, he changes the subject again. He's not staying on course. He starts talking about, but thanks be to God who always leads us in triumphal possession in Christ and through us spreads everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of Him. That's a great passage of Scripture that shows that Paul had victory here in Corinth, but we don't know how. It just changes so quickly. And scholars probably have been amazed. And if you were reading this letter, you would say, well, Paul, what happened? You left untold the story about Titus, about Corinth, and what happened there. But we know victory has taken place. But this is one of those situations you have to go to chapter 7. So that's what we did in chapter 7 one more. So if you have your Bible, and you want to go to chapter 7, please do. And we're going to start with verse 5. The first four verses are wonderful verses, but that's another story for another time. We just don't have time to handle all of what in these two chapters. But he talks quickly about the great confidence I have in you, the great pride I have in you. That's in verses 1 through 4. I'm greatly in all my our troubles, my joy knows no bounds. So he's talking about a successful story. But now in verse 5, he goes back to tell us what happens in this story. One of the points we're going to be trying to make in this brief message is that the joy of reconciliation comes when church unity prevails. But sometimes church unity does not prevail. Sometimes there's problems, there's conflicts, there's difficulties. Every church will have some of that. There's no church perfect in terms of harmony. And we have to deal with that. And sometimes we have a mixed understanding that fellowship should be perfectly pure. We should all love each other perfectly. Well, that doesn't happen very often. We have to work at that. We have to really dig down deep, because we're not sometimes willing to handle conflicts very well. We're not willing to be honest. As Paul is being here, is very honest, very open about his feelings about what happened there. And so he says, verse 5, when we came into Macedonia, this body of ours had no rest, but we were harassed at every turn. Conflicts on the outside, fears within. Does that sound like our beloved Paul? That he should have fears? Because he's the same man who wrote from Philippians chapter 2 about do not fear, do not worry, do not have anxiety about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication present your request to God, and he will answer those. He is your God of peace. He is the peace of God. But Paul also knows that perfectly, and that's how he lives his life. But in this particular circumstance, it's Titus that's going to be the keystone to the success of the reconciliation and the restoring of joy in the fellowship in Corinth. So as conflicts on the outside relate to the struggles he's had in other churches, and now that he's had in Philippi. Conflicts on the outside, fears within. One of the things we don't like to think about Paul is that he had certain fears, or conflicts, or problems. We like to have him above that, because when you read his great epistles, he speaks so strongly about how much confidence we should have in Jesus Christ. Jesus was everything to Paul. He loved Jesus more than anything else in the world. And so so that's what we when we think of Paul, that's what we usually think of. A man above problems. A man above conflicts. A man who does not have to deal with such things. But here he's telling us he does. He's concerned about the church. Even though what he did because the Holy Spirit had called him to do this. To speak strongly to them about areas of reformation, areas of sin that needed to be dealt with. So Paul was very open and very honest with the congregation. But he also had a pastor's heart. Paul was a great soul winner. He had seen thousands of people come to Christ. So he was a man of a great evangelist. But another thing we see about Paul, he had a pastor's heart. He really saw people hurting. And partly hurting because he had been so strong in what he had said to them. And they're needing to repent. They're needing to turn their lives back over to Christ fully. And so that's why he's struggling. That's why he's saying these conflicts on the outside, fears within. Then verse 6 says, but God, who comforts the downcast, ooh, boy. Paul is saying he was downcast. He was hurting. The great apostle Paul hurt at times. It's just impossible for some of us to believe and accept. And we don't think pastors should feel that way. We don't think church leaders should feel that way. But they do. They do at times. And they need help and they need encouragement. Often we're not open and transparent about our need of help. In our class that I just had with several Chinese, we were talking about trying to follow Christ, and sometimes the difficulties we have in being a witness and caring for people and ministering to people. And I shared with the class a situation when I was in college. And I go through a time of being downcast myself. I don't know what it was, but some kind of anxiety, some kind of emotional issue that I was really struggling with. And at 2 a.m. in the morning, I just felt like I needed to do something. I need to call somebody. So I called the pastor of my church at 2 a.m. in the morning. And guess what he did? He got out of bed. He came to the dorm, came to my room, and he took me to breakfast. He said, "Now, Bob, what's wrong?" I said, "I don't know. I just don't feel very good emotionally. I'm sad. I'm depressed." But I wasn't able to explain what was wrong with me. But he just listened and listened and listened. And about 5:30 in the morning, he took me back home. And that was so helpful to me. But it reminds me that, and since then, I've had to ask people for help. There have been some struggles, difficulties. Paul is our go-to person, our linchpin person, to say, if it's okay for Paul to do this, it's going for any of us. And when we're in the body of Christ, we need to be willing to be open and transparent about struggles that we may be having. Maybe not with the whole church, but certainly with an individual that we respect and we trust to share with. So Paul was greatly comforted by the coming of a person. We would think, usually, Paul would not need another individual. Well, we're, you know, in the West, we're so individualist thinking. Jeffersonian democracy, you know. We're independent, us Americans. We don't need other people. Well, the Chinese have taught us a lot of lessons about group understanding and relationships within families, that we do need each other. And so Paul was saying that, yes, God is my primary person, always. My primary go-to. God is first. Other people are second. But in this particular instance, God, who was number one in Paul's life, Paul understood that we needed Titus in this situation in Corinth, because I could not do that. And God helped me to understand that. His Holy Spirit helped me to say, Titus has got to be the one to do this. And so Titus did that. And notice what it says. But God, who comforts the dead, comforts us by the coming of Titus. And not only by his coming, but also by the comfort you had given him. He told us, and notice some of these emotional words here. He told us about your longing for me, your deep sorrow, your ardent concern for me, so my joy was greater than ever. When you read maybe Romans or Ephesians, Galatians, those are treatises, theological teachings that Paul wants us to understand. But occasionally, he really lets his hair down. He really lets us see into his personality and have the full view of who he is as a person. And this is one of those times. He's not talking theological. He's just talking about emotions and feelings. And so when you read from verses 5 to the end of that chapter, just go through this after and underline all of the emotional words, the words that express tension, that express sorrow, express joy. You see all of that encompassing in this one man's life. And I'm so glad we have that. It's a difficult passage to understand and struggle with, but Paul helps us to see that it's okay to struggle. It's okay to have difficulty. In this case, God blessed the situation where we did see a reconciliation happened, where there had not been reconciliation. We'll see that as we continue. And what did Titus have to say that comforted Paul? You see that in verse 7. He told us about your longing for me, your deep sorrow, your ardent concern for me, so that my joy was greater than ever. So, one thing that Paul desired more than anything else was not that he, in his own ability, was able to control and solve a church problem. but he was able to see how Titus was used of God to do that. And he brought him great joy. Paul did not have to be the answer person for every situation. Paul had the amazing ability to understand other people have to share in this. There's other people who have gifts that I don't have, strengths that I don't have, talents that I don't have. And so Titus was one of those kinds of people, that he had a way of relating to those people that at that moment Paul could not. So as I said before, Paul understood his limitations, but he also saw the great understanding that Titus had about this situation, and Titus was able to accomplish what he was unable to do because of circumstances. And in verse 8, Paul goes back to this. Notice some of these doubts here. Even if I caused you sorrow by my letter, I do not regret it, though I did regret it. Now, wait a minute, Paul. What is it? Did you or did you not regret it? Well, what he did regret was the hurt, the pain that people suffered. But he didn't regret it because he knew he was in God's will. He was speaking to the Corinthians about issues that they needed to deal with, that they were willing to deal with. And now they have repented. They have said, yes, we understand. We are, as far as we know, the fellowship is much stronger now than it was in 1 Corinthians, when we read about all those problems and difficulties and struggles. Remember, one was that they were getting drunk at the Lord's Supper. and people were going hungry. And so it was a mess. One of the interesting things I've just been reading about is a man named Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a great German theologian who was killed by the Nazis in 1945, just before the Allies came and took over that part of Germany. He was in Flossenbürg. But Bonhoeffer writes a lot about Christian fellowship in his book, Life Together. And he says that sometimes we have a mixed misunderstanding of what Christian fellowship is, that it has to always be nice and sweet and pretty. He said it not always is. There's struggles and there's pain and there's conflicts. And what God wants to do is work through those where we come to a point where we understand each other better, where it's what the Bible calls reconciliation among people who are in distress or who are angry with each other. Like the issue of having so many different groups supporting Peter or Paul or Apollos or Jesus. He's saying that God brought repentance. He talks about two kinds of repentance. This is very interesting. Now I'm happy, not because you were made sorry, but because your sorrow led you to repentance. That's verse 9. For you became sorrowful as God intended, and so were not harmed in any way by us. Godly sorrow, and he's going to tell us the difference between godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. It's very interesting and very helpful to us. Brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death. I'm reading a quote from William Barclay about this, and it might be helpful to share that with you. William Barclay says in his commentary, "Godly sorrow produces a true repentance, and a true repentance is one which demonstrates its sorrow by its deeds. The Christian proved their repentance by doing everything they could to mend the wretched situation that their thoughtless conduct had produced. Now they hated the sin they had committed and even hated themselves for committing it, and they labored to atone for it. A worldly sorrow is not a sorrow at all in one sense, but it is sorrow for its sin or for the hurt it may have caused others. It is only resentment that it has been found out. If it got the chance to do the same thing again and thought it could escape the consequences, it would do it." So a worldly sorrow is one in which we don't feel the sense of guilt. We don't feel the sense of sin that we've committed. We're not really being rebuked by the Holy Spirit. And so Paul says, What's happened here, though, is not worldly sorrow, but true godly sorrow. When I was a boy, maybe 15, 16 years of age, somewhere like that, I was at a church business meeting in my hometown of Eunice, New Mexico. And one of the most horrible, sinful things happened that night in a business meeting I ever experienced. It happened between several people in the church that had taken sides against another group of people who've taken sides. One side favored the pastor. The other side favored an education director. And I heard things said and done in that meeting that were very, very troubling. There wasn't any cursing necessarily, but yelling and screaming at one another. It was horrible. I just shook after that meeting. And I couldn't believe, because these were people who loved me, deacons and pastors and who had cared for me. I just could not believe this had happened. But it did. I witnessed it. I went on my life, went to college. I was very active in church. That's where I met the pastor at 2 a.m. in the morning. And God blessed. But several years later, the pastor of the First Baptist Church in Eunice and the pastor of the Highland Baptist Church that was a split off of the church because of that business meeting began to meet together and pray together. And they looked back at what had happened probably 10, 15 years earlier. I'm not sure exactly what it was. But they decided this was something that should never have happened in the Church of Jesus Christ. It was terrible. And the two churches had come together for some meetings and so forth. But these two pastors decided, let's do something in which we want to express our shame at what happened so many years ago. And so they wrote this letter that was published in the Eunice newspaper dealing with sorrow over what had happened and a repentance of what had happened. And saying that what happened was wrong and sinful and was not pleasing to God and was damaging to the community. And so they were saying, we hope that people have forgiven us for what we did. So, and sometimes churches do things like that. They do recognize. I'm glad that at Manuel and Grace and Glory, we don't have anything like that happening. And we're grateful for that. But at the same time, in both of our fine churches, there are some struggles. We all are going to have those. Individuals who aren't happy with another individual, and they don't know what to do with it. They don't know how to handle it. But the Bible gives us a passageway to deal with that, that leads to a joy in reunification and reconciliation. And that's so, so important. So Paul goes on to conclude what godly sorrow does. Let me start with, at every point you have proved yourself to be innocent in this matter. So though I wrote to you, it was not on account of the one who did the wrong or of the injured party. Paul may be going back here again to those verses earlier in chapter 2 where he talked about, now the person has repented, you need to accept that person and give him full fellowship back into the life of the church. That injured party, some people, as you might remember me saying a month and a half ago, that might have been Paul himself was the injured party. Some debated, was the injured, was it Paul, or was this person who was having a relationship with his mother-in-law? We don't know for sure. But he says, but rather, before God, you can see for yourself how devoted to us you are. By all this, we are encouraged. Paul was saying that if he was the injured party, look, I'm fine. Let's go on with life. I'm reconciled. I accept the fact that this person has expressed a need for forgiveness, and he's been forgiven. And then at the end of verse 13, in addition to our own encouragement, we were especially delighted to see how happy Titus was, because his spirit has been refreshed by all of you. I had boasted to him about you, and you have not embarrassed me. But just as everything we said to you was true, so our boasting about you to Titus has proved to be true as well. Paul has said, in spite of all the things this church has done, I have great hope that this church is reconciled, that this church is on a new pathway. And I'm proud of this church. I'm excited for this church. And Paul had told the Corinthian church how pleasing he was with Titus as well. And Titus has found this to be true. And he's reported back to Paul. Paul, you can't believe what's happened. We've had a true revival. People love each other. There's been reconciliation. People are supporting one another now. They're caring for each other. The church is growing. There's no longer divisions. Where there's been sin, sin has been reported, sin has been confessed, sin has been forgiven, and we're at a place where God wants us to be now. And in verse 15, he concludes with what he says about Titus. His affection for you is all the greater when he remembers that you were obedient, receiving him with fear and trembling. I am glad I can have complete confidence in you. So, what a wonderful, encouraging letter it was. But it didn't start out that way, did it? It started out really rough and difficult and complex. And some people would say, this church is not going to make it. This kind of church should just fold its tent and go home. But not God and not Paul. Believing that with God all things are possible. And so the Corinthian church was in that situation where some would say, it's impossible. That church cannot recover from all it's done. There's no fellowship there. They're angry with each other. There's sin among them. There's discord. But God has a wonderful way of bringing people together. In churches that are seemingly doing fairly well in fellowship, as far as one might think, I don't see any major problems or issues or difficulties. But every individual in church has certain struggles, certain cares, certain concerns that the church wants to care for and to help with. But for that to happen, there has to be more openness. People have to be willing to admit, hey, in this area of my life, I really need help. It could be health. It could be a problem with research. It could be a problem with what they're doing in terms of their job. Any number of things could be going on in our individual lives. So I think one of the principles here is that God can help a church, but he also can help individuals with problems and struggles and difficulties. It may not be easy, it may be very difficult, but God can bring the kind of solutions and health and wholeness that we all need. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this difficult passage, at least in the beginning, because Paul doesn't seem to be as strong and spiritually healthy, or physically healthy, or emotionally healthy, as we would like for him to be. But we have just rugged honesty here in terms of how Paul feels about things. All the emotions and feelings that come into this passage are very, very significant. It helps us to see that the Bible is very open, very honest, very transparent, that there are problems, there are struggles, but that God is able to help a church overcome obstacles and difficulties, as well as individuals also with God's help. But sometimes God's help comes from individuals, pastors and leaders, and just people who care for one another, who see a struggle, a difficulty, and are willing to walk alongside people who may be struggling with certain issues and life problems. I'm thankful in my own life that there have been many, 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 many people who have come alongside me and helped me in so many different situations in my life of over 50 years of pastoral ministry. And I'm so grateful for that. I see the importance of sharing life with one another, And that's what the church is all about, sharing life together. The struggles as well as the victories, the ups and the downs. And we sure see that in Scripture. Help us to see that in our lives here in both Emmanuel and Grace and Glory, of serving together, of being open and honest with one another, and rejoicing with victories. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.